I'll move to the conversation mode. So I'll tell you briefly about where my experience comes from. I started working in a sugar factory way back, and moved across sectors, worked into banking and financial services, worked with Citi, worked in telecom for almost 8.5 years of my career. And for last 2 years, I'm in a fashion retail company called House of Anita Dongre. You all know, and in Global Desi, right? So that's where I work. A few elements, I think, that we touched upon with the earlier two speakers. A few questions on which I will build. I'm sorry, I'm encroaching on our lunch time, but I'll keep it.
Lunch was always a little later.
So okay, that's fine then.
Yeah.
Okay. So one thing we talked about, I think, we talked about, should the culture be consistent across the company? And here we have somebody with 14 SBUs. Should the culture be consistent across the company? What's the answer?
Yes.
Should it be?
Yes.
Should it be? May not be. Okay. Should the culture be constant, consistent across different departments in the same company? Maybe, may not be, probably. The reason why I say this is because a lot of times our assumption is that culture is something that we see same across the organization. Probably yes, probably not, depending upon the subject that we are broaching upon. If it's about the value system, probably yes. If we are talking about performance on certain parameters, probably maybe, may not be. Probably a sales department or the frontline sales is more here and now, more living for the month, but the moment you move to the managers, senior managers, they are living for the quarter, for the year, or maybe 3 years, 5 years down the line. So that's how probably the culture could be different across different departments.
Sonal, I want to ask you, because you raised and you said you're in conversation mode. In Vodafone, and I'm taking that because we knew this thing there, but I didn't know you were early in Citibank, so that's also interesting. But if you look at Vodafone, it had such a large, network technology group, because there was a time when you had it all in-house and not outsourced. Yeah. And at the same time, you had a strong frontline and a strong customer service. So did you all actually have the same approach in terms of compensation and culture? I take what you said about, values in the organization were the same. But did you really have the same approach? These were completely different workforces.
They were very different, actually.
Yeah.
So because what we were trying to, what we are trying to establish as a culture is different strokes for different folks. And that the organization is not same-sided when we look at people with different skills, different capabilities, and different requirements. And that's where we did it. One thing also, since we are talking about, does compensation affect culture? One key thing from my experience, I'll tell you, in 2009, 2008, all of you probably, students may not remember as much, but all the professionals will remember, we had this entire surge of, all the new telcos, Videocon, all the Etisalats and Uninors of the world coming in. It was that time, everybody was trying to acquire more and more subscribers, and all my frontline sales used to get rewarded on the number of, connections that they would sell. And I was very new to telecom, in 2009, and that's when I sat with my distribution head, and we said, is that really rewarding the business? Because we had really graduated, we were all, market was hardly 30% penetration, and we were kind of hitting 40%, 50%. And at that time, we really, it was good 6 months of my life that I invested only in that subject of designing and really investigating what should be the incentive plan. We said we will graduate from SIM card selling. We will graduate to secondary and tertiary selling, which is how much do you sell to the distributor, to the retailer, and from retailer to the end consumer. So that's something that we introduced as a parameter because we thought that will drive the right behavior and behavior subsequently becoming a culture. What we also said is it's not only about SIM selling, but how much of my product or my brand will be the top of the mind recall, because in telecom, exactly like, and it subsequently became that way, it's a consumer business. It's like soap, toothbrush, everything, right? So mobile selling, mobile connection also became like that. So we also started saying that if there is a retailer shop, they're a Kirana shop, is the Vodafone scheme going to be the first one visible to the customer, or is it going to be the second or the third? So we started putting availability, visibility index, probably might sound a little technical, but simply saying, if you walk into the counter, will you see Vodafone first up or will you see it somewhere behind? So we started putting those kind of parameters into the incentive schemes. And we saw a lot of behavior change, and that subsequently became revenue, which used to be about, I mean, the SIM card sales, which used to be about 80% of incentive parameter, and people used to make a lot of money. Over the course of next 12 to 18 months, we graduated to revenue, this one, SIM card becoming hardly 10%, and we subsequently removed SIM card selling or connections as part of incentive plan. It only became, it became customer service, it became availability visibility index, it became tertiary sales. We subsequently graduated to burn also. That's the retailer has to push the recharge to the customer, and the customer has to subsequently burn also. So that's how the entire, incentive plan evolved. The behavior we were able to try and differentiate, and it subsequently changed a lot.
That was a good example of saying that how did you use compensation to actually get the business focus you want and also change the behaviors of people. But just asking you, because now you're in a fashion house, and the same question that I asked you, you would probably have designers who are very separate, you will have different groups of people. So do you all take that same differentiated approach that you all took in Vodafone? I mean, is that how you think about compensation?
I would still say it's a little early. We have tried to, we have started making some bit of changes because, again, this is a very, very emotive subject. The quantum of questions that we are getting, we all understand compensation is a very emotive subject for everybody. Currently, till last year, what we had was the carte blanche, everybody, the company performance, and across the board, everybody has this, depending upon the level, somebody has a 20% or a 50% weightage to the company parameter. What we are trying to do now is differentiating for the designers and for the merchandisers, because it's for the designers, just for the ease of everybody, they bring in the option plan, they bring in some 100 designs, out of that some 30 or a 40 get selected, and then they get bought by the buyers, and then there has to be a sell through. What we are now trying to do is, till now the designing department was working in a complete silo and it had no connection with the sales. What we are trying to do is that designer who has created some 100 designs, out of that 50 designs got selected, that's 50% conversion becomes one parameter. Then subsequently, out of those 50%, out of those 50 styles, how much is my full price sell through? So basically, how much is the design leading to the end result sales, and then subsequently, repurchase and repeat customers. That's, how.
So what you are saying is that rather than worry about the compensation mix and quantum and so on, by changing the parameters on which people are rewarded, compensation is paid to them, you're sort of trying to change and the behaviors and so on. A little bit like the journey Godrej was trying to say that they're getting to results. But here it's a very sharp focus on the kind of parameters that you are thinking about to bring that change.
Also because, till now we had a lot more, like I said, there was a lot more focus on the fixed pay. Everybody was scared, and there was very little money at risk. We call it money at risk, or there was very less variable to be earned. So we are trying to change the mindset. A lot of times the mindset around the performance-linked bonus or the variable pay is that it's the money which is withheld by the company, and if the company doesn't perform, utna paisa to bach gaya. So we are trying to move away from that mindset. We also had a performance differentiation where my top performer would only get about 1.1, which is 110% of target money, and my worst performer would get only be hit by 20%. 80% is again in the pocket. So now that's what we are trying to change again. We have increased the variable part a bit, and we will increase it further so that there is a substantial money there. What we are trying to change the mindset is this is not the money that the company is withholding. We have increased the multiplier. Somebody who was my role model would earlier get 110% of target money. Now that this person can get about 150%. And if the company performs good and the business the individual performance is role model, somebody can literally take 300 rupees out of 100 rupees target money. So about three times the incentive.
So I'm going to ask you the same question, because that's why we chose different industries. People like designers who are supposed to be very creative. And I'll say the same thing, you say in Vodafone, you think of the, IT apps, designers and so on, who are also, very creative in a different way. There's always this thing that, how can you put such high variable pay on creative people? Because, then you are spoiling my sort of just environment of creativity because you're making me so much focused, and this is not the right approach. So I'm just wondering about this, what you said now, that no, I want to take, I'm presuming it's also for the designers, you've changed the parameters, but I want to take up 110, say for argument's sake, 250. So what's the reaction from that? And I'm sure you've seen that earlier also, that reaction
yes.
that, you know, we had in Vodafone. What's your thought about that?
I think the trick that works in this case is make them party to the decision making. So what is happening is, you know, there's a lot of space for creativity, yes, in our industry. But at the end of it, you know, what drives business, what helps us retain and really pay well to all the designers and all other departments is the revenue that we generate. So hence, you know, getting that buy-in, because we have had those seasons where the designs were fantastic, we thought. The conversion from buying was fantastic, but the sell-throughs were not happening. And then we had to educate back, and the Department of Creativity, which was Creative Department, or the Design Department, which is lying in isolation, we had to circle it back and link it back with business. That bit of you know, conversation had to happen, and we are trying to get that marriage happen, where designers also become actively involved in business. They are more aware about, so they are not creating designs in silos, but they are also creating designs which are relevant to the market, which are relevant to the rest of the world. So that's how we are trying to establish the correlation. We are trying to get more relevant creativity rather than creativity at large.
Yeah, but because I've heard this subject n number of times from other creatives also, saying that when you do this consistently, you know, over a couple of years period, you actually find the level of creativity has gone down because we have all tweaking a fundamental thing that you think that will sell, and the pure creativity gets this thing. So I'm just sort of, you're still in the experimenting stage.
Yeah, we are in this experimenting stage, and in our discussion with the larger leadership team, that's what we have said, that probably we have some catching up to do in terms of getting this linkage. Subsequently, what we are trying to graduate thematically is, you know, from catch up, once we have caught up on the revenues and everything else, the sell-throughs, we will look at, you know, market disruptions that we, so the designers and creative team will start getting evaluated and getting more and more, I would not say rewarded per se, but more recognized on the market leading or market disruptive designs and creativities or the campaigns that we do. So that's something that we are going to do, probably that's still 18 to 24 months away, but that's how this is going to graduate. Yeah. Yeah, so very simply speaking, you know, if you have a low variable pay, what could it lead the culture to, and what the high variable pay? It talks a lot about your risk appetite, the ambitions that you drive in a company, the kind of target setting that you keep, and trust you me, if you have a high variable pay and if your fixed pay is at hygiene, and if your people's money is at risk, they will push you enough and more to get the, you know, good return out of their variable pay. I mean, that being the theme. One has to, I mean, there's no right and wrong answer, but probably each industry, each sector has to design to its appetite and basis what happens in the market. We have to contextualize that. Again, you know, we all talk about it, you know, the three P's of compensation. Again, there's no right and wrong answer. Depending upon the sector, industry, what we do, it probably, you know, a business-driven consulting organization can really pay for person and not exactly about pay for position, because each person is a revenue center for them. So depending upon that, we all need to, you know, very intelligently define and design the mix of what we do in on person, position, and performance. There's no right or wrong answer, but, you know, the slide, the cricket is my passion, so, you know, what happens when you know, give the wrong pay to the right person and the right, you know, right compensation to the wrong person. So we need to be a little cognizant of that. In compensation, at times, I would like to say we create culture also when we do certain things. At times, we also create culture when we don't do certain things. And that don't part is very difficult to identify, and we must need to be very, very cognizant of that. I think that's what makes the difference. What we do is, of course, is cognizant to us. We are doing it consciously. That's quite a simple answer.
I think that don't part requires some elaboration.
Okay, for example, when I say about don't, you know, in the last example of designers that we are talking about, if we just change the plan and we really don't communicate well, if we don't really make them partner to the decision, there will be a burnout, because it will again be perceived versus, you know, what we are saying is that somebody can earn more, somebody can really drive a behavior. Instead of that, it can be perceived as money being withheld by the company. You know, those kind of things. any change that you make, it has to be very widely communicated, widely discussed, and transparency. You know, we talked about transparency somewhere, I mean, quite a lot actually. You know, I have a strange mix of people in my workforce. You know, I have a 350 people corporate where I operate from. It's a building that houses about 1,000 people, and I have about 650, 700, you know, shop floor workers. And you know, once you know, I have marketing, finance, legal department who wants a 5-day working, you know, very corporate lifestyle and everything else. And we hire people from all kinds of corporates, even from at times Microsoft or Googles of the world. And then we have 700 workers, and both people look at each other. What has worked at times, and probably what we have faced a challenge on, is that, you know, these two different worlds who coexist in one environment, they have a huge brush off on each other. So we have started trying and communicate to the workers and to the production staff about the difference between the HO life and the production life. So the communication is the key, is what I say. At times when compensation we are talking about, a lot of people, a lot of youngsters, we said that, you know, legacy employees know each other, hence they are very comfortable sharing compensation with each other. I can tell you, all of us hire management trainees and, you know, trainees. They all have a WhatsApp group, mere ko ye mila, tere ko kya mila, and all that. It happens in like flash 5 seconds. Everybody knows everybody's compensation. It's become such a common subject. So really, confidentiality, to be honest, I think what the organizations need to do, and which is what I said about don't, we often don't communicate, and we are not very confident of our systems, processes, and the robustness of decisions. I think the more structured, methodical we are, a lot of us have started paying on potential than performance. I think the moment we have a confidence that our potential assessment is robust, the moment we have a confidence on our performance management system, I think it gives a lot of confidence to our own transparency. And beyond that, I mean, then you can take on any question. If your performance assessment is right, then you can really look into the eye of an individual and say, this is your compensation, this is where your compa ratio is, this is how you are assessed on potential, so be it. And if there are people who are solid citizens who've been there for a while, so be it. So it's all about that bit of transparency, and we don't do this very often. And of course, all of us are in, you know, different level of, all organizations are in a different level of maturity on the subject. But I think that's the don't part which I was referring to. A lot of times we need to do it, rather than we design the policy, we design the compensation strategy, but we don't do the communication strategy, the impact of it. So that's something that we must do a little more cognizant. Another live example which I'm going to share here. A lot of our compensation and how we pay, you know, whether we talked about the individual targets or about the team targets. I'll tell you from my experience in last 18 months, we have store frontline retail employees. We used to have a group incentive policy where the store will get a target, and if there are 5 people in the store, whatever incentive kitty gets generated because of revenue, if there is a 10 lakh rupee revenue, then probably 10,000 rupee gets generated. Everybody will get the equal money. Now there are pros and cons, but one good part of that framework was that everybody was equally enthusiastic about contributing to store sales. Now somehow we changed it to individual targets. Again, no right or wrong answer. Any policy is as good as its implementation. But what started happening, and quite common across organizations which have a similar framework, is now people have started fighting for customers. Now, it's like, you know, they go by rotation, and the moment the customer walks in, now the teamwork has gone out of the window. People are not willing to do things like visual merchandising, attending to the return customers, the customer who's returning something. I mean, all kinds of behavior have started happening. So what happened is, somewhere we had a culture that everybody was working towards one 10 lakh or a 20 lakh store target. Now everybody is chasing his own 2 lakh. So probably, you know, there could have been a more intelligent implementation or a mix and match. Probably somewhere we implemented in not so right manner, and probably not did good, great service to the culture on the shop floor level. So that's one example. Sales versus service. I'll tell you one of my most favorite example when I talk about it. You know, when you go into the restaurant and you ask your steward or the server to help you with the menu, and you ask him, what would you recommend? And suddenly you have a list of 10 items, and he looks at a couple of most expensive items and he suggests. You know, you may like it or you may not like that dish, but what comes to your mind? He's trying to fleece you, right? That's what happens, right? But probably he has the culture of getting revenues, right? That happens. On the other hand, when the same server, not the same one, but a different one, when you ask him that these are the five things that I've ordered, do you think it's sufficient? And he says that, I think five is too much. You were good with one, two, three. What do you think? You feel that probably his customer service is better than, he's getting more revenue, he's letting go of revenue, right? So that's where I say, what do we, or if we are that restaurant, if we are that company, what are we trying to inculcate in our people as a culture? Do you become that, I would not say the hospital's name, where doctors have a revenue target, or are we becoming that organization where quality is far better than the quantity? So those are the things that we have to really, we may say, the worst thing is that, at times when we say something, when we do something else. Having consistent culture is okay. Having, different cultures in different pockets is okay. Having aligned cultures is great. Having conflicting cultures is a disaster. And that's what we have to prevent. And that's where sales, service, all those kind of questions we need to answer. When we answer certain things, we also need to be aware of the questions that are arising of our answers. And that's the don't part that I talked about. We also build culture by what we don't do, rather than what we end up doing. I think that's pretty much I wanted to talk about.
Just a very interesting sort of observation on this, that in different parts of the organization, that by just having a different compensation system or what compensation is based on,
yeah,
I might actually create a conflicting culture between, say your example of sales and service. So coming back to that thing which Sunil said, 14 businesses, I'm having exactly same. How would you do what he said of having this, trying to have the same value set between these, while you see that I still do the right thing for the two functions?
Yeah, I think the answer still lies in the fact that, one thing, like I said, different strokes for different folks. I think the different business unit heads and different HR people, they need to realize that, having the sword of commonality at times cutting across is not a great idea. The organization itself should feel confident and should carry that bit of conviction through research, data, and everything else, that having different approaches to different people or different business units is actually doing good to those people themselves. And as long as they see meat in that, I think communication is the key. But having those catered, thoughtful nuances, customizations is very, very important. Otherwise, what happens? We were talking about public sector enterprise, everybody having similar policies, similar compensation and everything. But how many of those public sector enterprises ended up becoming successful? How many of them really survived? I've done my internship in quite a few public sector undertakings in Allahabad, in Kanpur, where, I saw similar culture. If you walk inside and you will not realize whether you are in BPCL or some other company, it's all same inside, because same lethargy, same everything, wahi hona hai, kaam karke kuch fayda nahi hai. And there would be one self-driven individual who works, but just because he's self-driven by that. But the idea of compensation is also, like we said, to have differentiation and create more people in that behavior, in that culture of performance, and becoming far, far bigger upskilled professionals.
Yeah. Any questions to Sunil or to Sonal? Or, well, thank you, Sonal, and I just call Deepa, Sunil. Thanks very much for a very good discussion.